Who here saw the Lord of the Rings, the movies, Lord of the Rings? Oh, man. No one here saw the Lord of the Rings. Wow. Those were some of the best movies made in the last generation. Those are amazing books. Has anyone read the books? What? Wow. Well, let me tell you a little bit about how those books, and the books are better than the movies, no surprise, but the whole conceit of the book is that there is one ring of power, one ring to rule them and all in darkness bind them. And they have to destroy the one ring and to save the world, etc. And they get to the point where after three books, they destroy the one ring. And when it gets to the point where you've saved the world, what do you expect next in a book, right? Or in a movie? You expect to turn the page and read some form of, and they lived happily ever after, the end. And you get to you read about the destruction of the One Ring, and you turn the next page, and there's another chapter. It's kind of funny. So you read the chapter, and they're going back, and you get done with that chapter, and there's another chapter. There are another 50 pages after you destroy the One Ring. There are three chapters left after you destroy the One Ring and the Lord of the Rings. And you keep. And I found myself thinking, my 12-year-old self reading the Lord of the Rings, thinking, why am I still reading this? Why are we still reading this? Right? Why is this not done yet? And I thought of that sensation, why am I still reading this? As I read John 21 this day, because we were looking at John 20 last week, and here's how John 20 ends. John 20 ends, therefore many other signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these have been written so that you might believe in Jesus Christ and have life in his name. What do you expect to be the next words after that? The end, right? Or amen, or something. You expect to flip the page, go on to the next book. You flip the page and you don't go to the next book. There's chapter 21. Why is there another chapter to John? We just wrapped it up. Well, why aren't the credits rolling? Right? I find it useful as I'm trying to answer such questions to think about in what context these books were first written, and to think about the people who were first hearing them, and to show you how important that can be, I want to compare John to Mark, right? At the end of Mark is the first gospel written. It's written about the 60s or so. And so Mark is written, and when Mark is written, you have first and second generation Christians, people who had met Jesus or who had been told about Jesus by someone who had met him, people who were there and saw him after the resurrection, right? And so when Mark ends, Mark 16, verse 8, this is how it ends. Two women, they go to the grave, they find the grave empty, they find an angel. The angel says to them, he's not here, he is risen. And the two women are terrified and they run away. The end. That's how Mark ends, right? That's how the Gospel of Mark ends. And so you think, well, that's a weird ending. And you look up from reading that for the first time, you look at all the people who are reading this to you, and you say, well, what's next? And they tell you what's next, because they were there. They know what's next. There's all the first and second generation Christians who can say, and then we saw Jesus here, and then we saw Jesus there, and this is how we've been following Jesus since then. And so there's this very clear sense that the next chapter of Mark is what the people right there can tell you, because they were there. Right? First gospel written, so a lot of people kicking around who'd been there. The gospel according to John is written 30 years later. It's written in the 90s, like 95, give or take. At this point, we don't have any first or second generation Christians. The people who are reading the gospel according to John, you know, they're all third and fourth generation Christians at this point. And so they're facing things, they're having to react to things that those people reading Mark for the first time never had to. Like the people to whom Mark had been written, when you asked, well, who should lead us? Well, who should lead if you have a bunch of the disciples still alive? Well, the disciples should lead us, obviously, right? You get to John a generation later, the disciples are gone, right? They've all died, right? Paul, he's dead. All the people who traveled with Paul, they're dead too. And so the church that reads the gospel according to John in the 90s AD, they have a question in front of them that the church that read the gospel of Mark never had to ask. Who should lead us now? Right? Who should lead us now? And so what we have here at the end of the gospel according to John is this addendum, this sort of postscript that tells us a little bit about Peter. Because as you're starting to think about who should lead us, what are you thinking about? Well, who led us first? Peter, the great bishop of Rome, the great leader of the disciples. We should find ourselves a leader like Peter. Right? So John wants to leave them a note about Peter. Before you get too high and mighty on Peter, let me make sure you remember something important about leaders, something important about Peter, right? So the people who were in the 90s who were picking leaders, you got to remember Peter, he's been dead for 60 years, right? Peter died in 64 with the persecutions of the Emperor Nero. He was crucified upside down because he didn't feel like he was worthy to be crucified upside right like Jesus. And so he was dead. He had died for his faith. He had been the bishop of Rome. He had led the disciples. He was one of the original disciples. He's been dead for a while, and after someone's been dead for a while, hero worship sets in, right? After someone's a great leader's been dead for a while, you tend to forget all the things they messed up. And if you want an example of it, Ronald Reagan. Right, Ronald Reagan. Is the Ronald Reagan that we talk about today the same Ronald Reagan as in January 1983 who had a 35% approval rating according to the Pew polls? No, right? The Ronald Reagan that I heard about growing up, I went back and I studied Ronald Reagan. It's not the same Ronald Reagan. Same thing happens with Kennedy, right? Kennedy, this great leader, got us through the Cuban Missile Crisis. Well, he also was on some major painkillers. And I mean, there are issues on any great leader. You get a generation out, and all of a sudden, they're wonderful. I'm not saying that Reagan and Kennedy weren't great presidents, but what I'm saying is they're not as great as they get portrayed after about 30 or 40 years. Same thing with Peter. Right, we're about 30, 40 years away from Peter for these people reading the Gospel of John. And, you know, we need a leader like Peter. Well, let me tell you about Peter. So John tells this story, this moment, before Peter turns into the Peter that they remember. Right, we come to this moment on the beach. And there is Peter, and he is not leading the disciples out across the world to tell people about the good news of Jesus. I mean, Jesus has shown up to them multiple times. They know about the resurrection. Thomas has made his great confession. But Peter, the leader of the disciples, he's not leading them, right? What is Peter leading them to do? What's Peter say? Let's go fishing. Okay. Right? Jesus is alive and you want to go fishing? Okay, well, we'll go fishing. Leader, here we go. Right? And so they go and they fish. And why does he want to go fishing? Right? I have a feeling the reason he wants to go fishing is because he can't get over something that had happened, right? Something that had happened. When Peter was standing next to a charcoal fire, he had denied Christ three times on the night in which Jesus was betrayed and the cock had crowed. And at this point, you know, Peter is the leader. He's the one who gets people up and gets going, but he has experienced a type of failure that has scarred him. We all have moments that you think back and you mess up bad. And the worst thing about messing up really badly is not in the moment. It's how you lay in bed at night and remember it. And you think about it and you dwell on it, right? And you think back, how could I have done that differently? And why did I do that? And how could I be so stupid? Right? Peter's experienced that type of failure. He failed Jesus. He denied him three times. And I think what's happening with Peter, the reason he wants to go fishing is because he believes that he has lost all right or ability to lead ever again. Right? And so he can't lead him, so he just is going to go out and go fishing. Except Jesus keeps on showing up. And so Jesus shows up this time, and he beckons them in. He tells them where to throw their nets. They catch 153 fish, and they come on in, and they start to eat. Right? They start to eat, have some fish, have some bread. And when the meal is done, when they have finished their breakfast, Jesus looks at Peter and says, Peter, do you love me? You know, how often is someone in your family, your mama, to ask you, do you love me? Now, of course I love you, mama. I mean, whatever, right? Someone asks you again, no, really, do you love me? Yes, I love you, mama. It's when Jesus asks the third time that I think it says that this is when Peter was sorrowed. He was grieved. It bothered him. I think this is the moment you can feel the eye contact, right? Why are you, you just asked me a third time. That's when it sinks in. Jesus and Peter are sitting next to a charcoal fire. The word for charcoal fire, it's not just any word for fire. It's a specific word for a charcoal fire, and it only shows up twice in all of the Bible, which tells us this detail matters. And the first time that Peter had shown up by a charcoal fire was the night he denied Christ the third time. And so here is Jesus sitting next to a charcoal fire with him, shooting the breeze just like Peter had been that night before, and he asks him that third time, do you love me? And I can just feel how he responds. Notice how he gets a little bit more verbose this time. This time he's not just saying, yes, Jesus, I love you. He says, Lord, you know all things, and you know that I love you. And then Jesus responds, feed my sheep. This moment transforms Peter, because from this moment on, Peter's not taking the disciples to go fishing anymore. Right? From this point on, he takes them and he leads them, and they start spreading the gospel in the beginning of the church. It starts here we go, right? But it begins because Jesus meets with Peter, and Peter is made whole. Peter is forgiven. Peter is ready, right? He's never going to again respond to being wrong by falling apart. And he is going to be wrong. Oh my God, Peter's going to be wrong. Read Acts 15 sometime if you want an example. Peter really does whiff. But never again will being wrong cripple him like it did that time. How often do you wish you could go back and get something right? How often do you think you wish you could go back? Right, and this is what is being offered to Peter, the chance to get it right. He denied Christ three times, and now he has a chance to recommit himself, to confess his following three times. And this is grace. This is what grace looks like. It transforms Peter. It's the type of thing that we need to hear about, because we all have moments that we just desperately wish we could do again. I think of them as our of the year moments. Right, so Olivia and I are getting to have our parent of the year. Hear that very cynically. Right, I was at home. Olivia was gone. Sophia had just started dance lessons, and she wanted to dance. And so I'm holding her as she's spinning under my arm, and she's spinning faster and faster. I'm spinning her, and she goes faster and faster. And then she's laughing. Right, she's laughing. She's loving it. And then she stops laughing, and she starts whimpering. She starts holding her right elbow. Right, we've gone from she's having a good time to, oh my God, Dad of the Year Award, I just broke her. Right? And we go to Dr. Esmeyer, and as he remembers, you might have messed up an epiphyseal plate. I have broken her growth plate. And it was fine, right? It was fine, it healed, it was just a sprain. But that was a moment that I will never forget, because right? We have these moments, parent of the year, husband of the year. I've had a few preacher of the year moments. Oh God, preacher of the year. Right? We have these moments where we are ashamed. Right? And you know they're bad when you hate to see the other person again because you feel so bad about it. And that's gotta be what Peter is feeling right now. Right? Disciple of the year. I denied him three times and he keeps on coming back to talk to me. And Jesus sits down and there's a second chance. Right, there's a second chance here. There's an opportunity to repent and to turn, to follow, to rebuild. Once Peter experiences this, he's ready to lead. But I don't think we should ever forget that the two greatest leaders of the early church, Peter and Paul, Peter forsook Jesus and Paul persecuted him. They're not great leaders because they were always right. They are great leaders because they were forgiven and they lived out of that forgiveness. What makes for a great leader, someone who can truly feed the sheep, is not someone who is perfect, but someone who is forgiven, and having been forgiven, then extends that grace to others, forgiving in the same way. This was important for the early church to remember, because remember, they're going to pick their next leaders, and they're in this moment of thinking, you know, if we can just find someone like Peter, someone who is this perfect, someone who had it all figured out. No. You need to find someone like Peter, someone who is forgiven, and someone has been transformed by it. All right? We don't look for perfection in leaders. We look for forgiveness and humility. I think this continues to be an important story to hear about the nature of leadership. Right? We are in the nature of a democracy as we pick our leaders, and over time we're going to have different leaders. And specifically in the Methodist Church, You're going to get a new pastor someday. I'm not in any hurry, don't worry. But you're going to get a new pastor one day, and this temptation in the Methodist system is, you know what, if we can just wait out this Yahoo, maybe Peter will show up next time. Admit it, you've thought it before. The opposite happens too. Pastors, I know pastors, they've said to me, you know what, if I can just survive this church, maybe I'll get to a good church next time. You're never going to have a perfect pastor, and no pastor's ever going to have a perfect church. What you're going to have, hopefully, is someone who's been forgiven and who knows it and forgives others in the same way. And that's all you can ever ask of a church. I've said multiple times, this is how I evaluate a church. Can a church forgive itself and get back on track? It's not do you all always get along, you don't. It's can you forgive? As Jesus forgave Peter, and then Peter forgave others. That's what makes a great leader. That's why John keeps on typing, writing at the end of the gospel. Right? He has one more thing they need to know as they start picking their leaders. The best we can look for in any leader or any pastor is someone that knows that they are forgiven, has the humility to say so, and is willing to be that forgiving with others. And so as we seek to do what Jesus asks, that's what we need to cultivate as we feed his sheep. Amen. It's easy to hear about Peter and think that's great for leaders, but it doesn't apply to me. There is always someone looking up to you. Each one of you is a leader to someone else. Right? Every one of you is. And so go forth and, like Peter, know that your darkest day is not your last day. You are forgiven. You are redeemed. Go forth now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.